greatly delight in his commandments. Your descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever.
The annual meeting of the Presbyterian Church of Coshocton is hereby called and will begin at approximately 1 for the purpose of receiving reports and voting on the terms of call for your pastor and our revised bylaws. Copies are available in the assembly room and downstairs during the lunch prepared by our Christian Education Committee and other volunteers. If someone would like to assist me in home communion on Wednesday, please see me for worship, any deacon or elder. Included in our prayers this morning, Bill Gill's birthday is February 10th, and we give thanks with the Sykes family for Megan being awarded a scholarship at Bowling Green and Kimberly going to the OSU Med School. Congratulations, Dave. I'm a proud grandfather. Pride goeth before the fall, but since he's already seated, there will be no damage. Just be proud. Continue to keep in prayer Lord Porteous, who's at Windsorwood, and also Reverend Bracken Foster, the pastor out at Christ UMC Church, will be leaving intensive care in a few days. And Bob Crown, Joe Coble's brother, is now home. Jen Spear, having back surgery on the 13th. And Rolanda Hunt is going through a series of tests, and she is Reverend Phil Hunt's wife. Are there other prayer concerns for? Yes, Colin?
Always waiting for the holy, 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 holy
pray for peace and for the generosity of God's creation around us. We give thanks for our musicians this morning. Yes?
Prologue is trying to adopt two boys from and the immigration status and all that is still up in the area.
A friend of Barb's working on immigration and status with changes policy are interrupting that, so we pray for adoptive families. That was the lesson this morning in the Bethel class, adoption. Okay. Thank you. Will the children come forward for the children's sermon with Sarah Swigert?
Everybody get a rock?
I saw these yesterday, Mom.
Okay, let's pray. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for never giving up, never getting tired, and never changing. You are our rock, and we praise you. Amen.
Says, when you pass through the waters, when you pass through the fire, not if. She said, we all like to think that leading a good Christian life inoculates us from difficulties or heartache. On the other hand, it doesn't do that, but it does give us the assurance that during those times, God is with us. Carrying us.
Thank you.
This morning I received a phone call from Christmas Bob. Bob passed away last night. He went deadly that night. So our prayers are with Grace and with Cameron and with Frank and with Mark and with Debbie. We don't have any details of the plans yet. But we ask for God's peace to be with him, and we ask for these words of scripture to be with us. Let us pray. Lord, all are precious in your sight, and we give thanks because you love us, and because you love us, we can love one another. May your peace be with us, not as the world gives, but as you can give. In Jesus' name.
We may be obedient to your will and live always for your glory. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58, verses 6 through 9a. Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." The word of the Lord. Others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
K-I-S-S. Keep it simple, stupid. And so he did. He just kind of put it onto the level of the Corinthians. which also means, as God speaks to us this morning through Paul's letter to the Corinthians, he's going to keep it simple. I'm reading from the Message translation. You'll remember, friends, that when I first came to you to let you in on God's masterstroke, I didn't try to impress you with polished speeches or with the latest philosophy. I deliberately kept it plain and simple. First, Jesus and who he is. Then Jesus and what he did. Jesus crucified. I was unsure of how to go about this and felt totally inadequate. I was scared to death of you all, but if you want the truth of it. And so nothing I said could have impressed you or anyone else. But the message came through anyway. God's Spirit and God's power did it, which made it clear that your life of faith is a response to God's power, not to some fancy mental or emotional footwork by me or anyone else. Whoever knows what you're thinking and planning except you yourself? The same with God, except not only does God know what God is planning and thinking, he lets us in on his thoughts. God offers a full report on the gifts of life and salvation that he is giving us. We don't have to rely on the world's guesses and opinions. We didn't learn this by reading books or going to school. We learned it from God, who taught us person to person through Jesus. And we're passing it on to you, you Corinthians, in the same firsthand, personal way. Spiritually alive, we have access to everything God's Spirit is doing, and we can't be judged by unspiritual critics. So this is the question that Isaiah is asking. Is there anyone around who knows God's Spirit? Anyone who knows what he is doing? The question has been answered. Christ knows, and you have the mind of Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Do you have time for Jesus? There was a hermit who lived out in the forest, and he would cut enough wood during the course of the summer to heat his little cabin all the winter long. But one fall day, early this particular year, he received the weather alert that a storm was coming. And because he had not yet cut enough wood, he rushed out to his wood pile. Now he pulled out his saw, and by then he forgot to put it away. It was a little rusty, and he knew it was a little dull, and he realized it really needs to be sharpened. And he paused, and he looked first at that half pile of wood that was cut for the winter, not enough, and then he looked over here at the pile of wood that needed to be cut so he could stay warm, and he kind of shook his head. So instead of sharpening the axe, he decided to just start cutting. And as he worked, he noted the harder he worked, the duller the saw became. And he was working harder and harder, and he kept telling himself, as he was cutting the wood, I need to stop and sharpen that saw. But he continued to cut anyway. At the end of the day, he fell exhausted next to a sizable pile of uncut wood. Now, this man was not stupid. He was not ignorant. He knew his saw desperately needed sharpening. He also knew that the more he cut, the duller the saw would become. Yet he could not bring himself to stop and sharpen the saw. This man was a victim of the logic of urgency. For most of us under pressure, urgency drives out any thought of maintenance. That seems too routine. Doing the right thing is driven out by that need to be busy and just get to the task and get going with it. Every organization and every family has a series of systems, habits, or traditions that tend to wear down. We find ourselves working harder than ever, yet we benefit less and less from our efforts. As tension mounts, we look for someone to blame. When an organization sees that something needs to be done, the answer is always, there is no time. When you're a family and you're working hard to put food on the table or to take care of the kids, there's no time to do that. There's no time for prayers. There's no time for devotions. I have to get busy and do this. But all it means is that future crisis coming down the road will come even sooner. Will it come? It will occur. Because there is a price to be paid for answering urgency instead of maintenance. Now, Robert Quinn has written a book about organizations. And he says, change is hell. Yet not to change, to stay on the path of slow death, is also hell. So I guess we have two choices, hell or hell. That's not much of a choice. But we're all afraid to take those risks, and we're just too busy to sharpen the saws. We just don't want to be beginners again. We're in the midst of that work, and we feel like we can just keep doing it forever. And then Quinn says these amazing words from your bulletin cover, build the bridge as you walk on it. Build the bridge as you walk on it. If you've seen pictures of Brooklyn Bridge under its construction and they're coming out from one shore and from Manhattan and you hope they meet in the middle, bridge builders build the bridges as they walk on it. It's an amazing thing to see and to trust that someone has a plan and that the two sides will meet in the middle. That somehow God has a plan for our lives, even when we think we're not sure what that next step is going to be. Build the bridge as you walk on. Now, in the midst of that wisdom, we hear these words Kim read from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Be salt and light. Sounds good. Be salt. Be tasty with your friends and neighbors. Be a light. Let your music be a light to others in dark times. Turn to a friend and cheer them up and put a little zest into their life with salt. Be salt and light. Problem is, if we're to be salt and light, we have to give ourselves away. I can't be salt for somebody else with a salt packet in my pocket. I can't be light to someone else and just hold that candle lighter and say, no, we're not lighting the candles this morning. I have to give away the light. I have to give away the salt. It's a reminder that all of us have to die a little bit to ourselves and definitely die to controlling the situation and dying to that certain amount of security. How do we do that? Let me give you a little exercise that you might try at home. And it's about the way that we think and feel. Feelings and our thoughts always get ahead of ourselves somehow. And they aren't always good. We're often captured by bad thoughts, bad thinking, but it's just what comes first to our mind. Situation comes up, and that part of our brain we access first is often a thought, or especially a feeling that drives a thought. So here's the exercise. Imagine yourself along a riverbank, and at any moment of our lives, those certain thoughts come to our mind. Think of a crisis that you're going through. Think of some words that somebody has just told you that put you down and made you feel very small. All right, choir, do it again. That was awful. You were all flat. The elbows came in too late. The basses came in too early. You're going through a crisis. And at that point, you might say to yourself, what am I doing in this choir? I can't sing. And then somebody reads a scripture and you say, I don't understand that. And you say, oh, I'm just going to doze off today. I haven't any idea what John's talking about. Or you go home and you have thoughts like a husband or a wife makes you feel inadequate. Or there's something you were supposed to do and you forgot about it. Or there was a long list of things to get done by noon and it didn't happen. So imagine yourself sitting on the bank of this river and imagine boats going by, and they're all going upstream. And each one of those boats, as you sit there and ponder about your life, your thoughts, and your feelings, has a name. One of them might be my anxiety about tomorrow. Something's coming up tomorrow, and you're worried about it. Name that boat as it goes by. That's the boat called my anxiety about tomorrow. The next one might be objections from my husband. And your husband has told you something that's objectionable about you. Name the boat. Let it continue going down the stream. Every judgment, every thought, everything that says, I don't do that well, name the boat let it go downstream. Now, this is a difficult exercise because there's something weird about us as Christians and about people. We want to hang on to those very thoughts. Well, I really can't sing, so it doesn't do any good for Chuck to yell at me. I can't do any better. We actually, a good singer, as it goes down, a good singer, as it goes downstream, we grab the boat and ask it to come back. Yeah, I want to go on that boat, because if I can tell Chuck I can't sing, then I don't have to get any better. Or to put it another way, I don't have to stop and sharpen my saw. Now, this is also an exercise in nonviolence. We have to be nice to ourselves when we tell ourselves, I'm not a good singer. Well, maybe I should practice a little bit more. Maybe I should listen to Chuck's direction. Maybe I need to be reading the scripture in the pew as the liturgist is reading it. Maybe I need to talk to my wife, my husband, my son, my daughter, my brother, my sister a little bit more. Be kind to yourself, because each of those are a real part of each of our lives. And if you learn to handle your own soul tenderly and lovingly, you'll be able to carry this same loving wisdom out into the world and be just as kind and tender to others. We're all beginners when it comes to love. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever is without love does not know God, for God is love. Unfortunately, we Christians like to take a couple of shortcuts. We say to ourselves, if I read the Bible, I'm born of God. If I go to church today, I know God. And if I obey those commandments, I'll be loved by God. But John says it's simply about loving one another. And how do we do that? We have the mind of Christ. Psalm 85, verse 4. Help us again, God of our help. Why not help us make a fresh start, a resurrection life? Then your people will laugh and sing. We don't have to worry about being off key. We don't have to worry about every verse of scripture. We don't have to worry what a husband or a wife or a minister or a teacher or a president or a congressperson says about us. We can just let that go downstream and listen to God. Why not help us make a fresh start, a resurrection life? So when our minds aren't functioning well, God offers the mind of Christ. Let us pray. O God, let your light break forth like the dawn, and may your healing spring up quickly within us, that we might have that resurrection life of a fresh start. In Jesus' name, amen.